Good morning, Duck Church.
Good morning.
It's good to see y'all this morning in the house of the Lord. We're going to get started praising the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's stand together, and we invite you to sing and clap and dance for the glory of the Lord this morning with us. Let's sing.
Begins to change.
word takes on flesh and soul finds faith. With the unfulfilled, our satisfied, and the unknown scars are reconciled. It's an open door to brand new. Close in the presence of the Savior. I just wanna be in the room, wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving till you do. I just wanna be in the room, wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving till you do. Wanna see the blind receive their sight, hear the praise of voices start to rise. Every child of God baptized with fire, but right here in the presence of the healer. I just wanna be in the room, wanna be in the room. Till you do. Oh, I don't wanna miss it. I just wanna be in the room. Wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving till you do. The roof and lower me down, whatever it takes to get me to you. That's right. Tear off the roof and lower me down, whatever it takes to get me to you. Tear off the roof and lower me down, whatever it takes to get me to you. Roll every stone, push through the crowd. God, I wanna see you break through. Tear off the roof, lower me down, whatever it takes to get me to you. Roll every stone, push through the crowd. God, I wanna see you break through. In the room, wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving till you do. I wanna miss it, I just wanna be in the room. Wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving till you do. Ho! Tear off the roof and lower me down, whatever it takes. Get me to you. Roll every stone. Push through the crowd. God, I wanna see you break through. Tear off the roof. Lower me down. Whatever it takes to get me to you. Roll every stone. Push through the crowd. God, I wanna see you break through. I wanna see you break through.
If you would take a second and greet some of the folks who are standing around you.
Today we have the pleasure of inviting some of our friends from All God's Children
United Methodist Church in the Place of Possibilities. They're here to share the message with Miss Laura. So we're excited to greet them and to welcome them to worship with us today. If you would, in your bulletin, there's a little connection card that looks like this, okay? If you would pull it out and fill it out with as much information as you feel comfortable sharing, that would be great. And then make sure where it says service I attended that you tell us which one it was. And then if you're a first or second time guest, you can check off that spot too. And then I know you haven't had enough time for this, but flip it over to the other side. And there's a spot there that says my next step today is to. Later in the service, we're going to give you an opportunity to respond to the message and to our worship service today. So just be aware of those, and we'll give you a chance to fill that part out at the end of the service. Everybody's welcome here. We want to make sure that you all feel welcome to be here in the house of the Lord today. And we are going to set our minds on prayer this morning and offer prayers to the Lord. Are there any prayer requests that we have that you all would like to share? Jason's throat. All right, anybody else? Yes, Leanne. Where?
W-A-R.
Okay, yeah.
Stephanie and Brian.
Okay.
Tyler Kate,
okay. Cheyenne. I got you. Chris. Yes, eh? Miss Laura. Linda. I'm going to say Christy R. Because I cannot spell that. Bev, Chris, Eli, and the Botson family, yep. Yep, Paige. Dontrell? Okay. Thank you. David, did you have one? Yep, David. We love you too, David.
Yeah.
He said, I love you and all y'all too. Shane.
Prayers for Kaylee and also for my mother who just recovered from COVID last week. Getting better, not 100% yet.
And we also need to pray for Deb Benton too, our choir director. She's got some sort of something that's not going away. Do you have that? Okay. Doug.
Prayers for my son-in-law, daughter, and granddaughter, Travel Mercy, since they go to Alabama.
James. Okay. All right, I don't want to move on too fast. We've got a lot. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we're so thankful that you are a God who sees us, that even when we feel invisible or unwanted or like our problems don't matter to anybody else but us, you see us because we are your kids. And we thank you that you are already involved in the lives of these people that we've named, but we want to bring them before you. Because we know that prayer works, and we know that prayer brings about healing and wholeness in a way that we can't explain, but that only you can do. And so, Lord, we lift up Jason, the Ware family, Stephanie and Brian, Tyler, Kate, Hal, Luke, Kelly, and Cheyenne, Chris, Miss Laura, Christy, Bev, Chris, and Eli, the Botson family, Dontrell, Kaylee, Debbie, Deb, the persecuted church around the world, Doug's family, and Colin and Chloe. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer for those who are weak. And Lord, where we all feel weak, please make us strong by your grace. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. If you would you welcome Miss Laura Early to share the message this morning?
Aiden, would you like to do it for me since you've already heard it twice? Guess not. All right, looks like you stuck with me. Is there anybody that I'm meeting for the first time? They didn't tell you. You can slip out quickly if you want to. And those of you that are meeting me for the second or third time, you came anyway, so thank you, Jesus. But I tell you what, it is good for my soul to be in the house of the Lord in Duck on the first Sunday in 2024. If I asked you what is today? Some of you might say, well, Sunday. Some of you might say it's the day after Saturday. You know, we love our Saturdays. And some of you might say it's my birthday. It might be your birthday. But for all of us, within the sound of my voice, this is the first Sunday of 2024. Now, I don't know about you, but 2023 was one of the hardest years of my life. It really was. There was so much fraction and so much heartache and so much pain. And, you know, we thought we had it behind us because COVID was coming to an end, right? And then we get slammed with all other kind of things and we just kind of like dogs with our tongues hanging out of our mouths just going, Now, if you say, I'm not doing that, I'm thinking, yes, you are. You are. It's been a tough year, and I don't mind saying to you that I can stand up here in the precipice, jumping off point of a new year because of who Jesus is. And today I hope to impress upon you what you need to do with that, with who Jesus is. I told Amy a couple of weeks ago that I wanted to focus on Psalm 16:11. Psalm 16:11 says, in his presence, whose presence?
Jesus.
And who is Jesus? Who is God? God is, finish it.
Love.
Say it again.
God is love.
Say it one more time.
God is love.
So I believe that. I think you probably believe that too. So in his presence, what does that mean, Amy? That means in the presence of love. But it doesn't end there. Psalm 16:11 says, in his presence there is fullness of joy. I believe everyone within the sound of my voice lives knowing they live in the presence of a God who loves them. There is nothing you can undo to undo God's love for you. You can't undo your faith. It might get weak, but you can't undo it. God's already tied you up in his love. You can't undo righteousness because he is our righteousness. There's nothing you can undo to undo God's love. But we live in a world, do we not, that makes us feel like joy is for somebody else. Those that know me well know that my favorite word is joy. You know, I'm the one that goes to Hobby Lobby 2 days after Christmas and buys everything that's 60, 75% off that says joy. It's in every room of my house. Joy. In his presence, in the presence, the fullness, the love of God, there is fullness of joy. And some of you might be running on empty. Even though this is the first Sunday of the new year. I do the same thing every December 31st. If on December 31st of next year you want to find me, call the local Barnes & Noble in Greenville, North Carolina. That's where I'll be. And I'm there on a mission because I believe God has something for me to lead me into the new year, something that will guide and guard and move and lead me. Usually I go to the religious section first. You've seen it. It says, religion. And I'll go, well, I've read that, and I've read that, and that one didn't do much for me. And, you know, Max Lucado has said that 1,000 times. That book's going to say the same. I mean, I love Max Lucado, but once you've read one or two of his books, you've read them all. So anyway, I stay in the religion section for a little bit, and then I start to meander out and about into the store, hoping that a book will just literally fall off the shelf. That did happen to me one time. And I'm waiting for God to say, this is the one. So I'd already told Amy we were going to talk about joy the first Sunday of the new year. And I turn a corner. I don't know what section I'm in. I'm really not paying attention, but I know I'm not in the religious section. But this book just jumped out at me. You know how they let them face the front? It was facing the front, and it says, joy is my justice. And I said, yes, Lord, yes. Because if ever you wanted to look at a person that cares about justice, who cares about equity, who cares about us all being a family, you're looking at that person. Justice is important to me. And I've spent the last 35, 40 years of my life literally helping other people feel that justice, that they matter. But what I'm finding is that even as I speak about justice, most people don't combine those two words together, justice and joy. When we think about justice, we think about people's hard times. When we think about justice, we think about people who don't have as much as we do. When we think about justice, maybe we think about our own injustice in the world. But when we say justice, the first word that comes out of your mouth is not joy. But I made a commitment, not a resolution. I'm not going to eat less chocolate. Might eat a little bit more if I decide I want to do that. I'm not going to try to lose any weight. I'm going to walk a lot, but I'm not trying to lose weight. I'm just trying to be healthy. Whatever your resolution is, it'll probably end in February. That's what they say. So I don't make resolutions. I make commitments. Before we leave this place today, I want you to make a commitment for joy to be your justice, for justice to be your joy. And I prayed long and hard about how to do that because joy is literally my favorite word. It is a word that guides me. It turned me around one time when my life had gotten very dark when my mother passed away. A lot of people thought I'd have to take a sabbatical when she died because we were so close. They didn't know if I could maneuver, navigate life without her. But she looked at me with those steel blue eyes and she said, you got more work to do. You understand? And all you said to her was, yes, ma'am. So I knew I had to carry on. And one day I was sitting at the beach just waiting for the sun to come up. And I turned, as we do when we say, God showed me something. And he showed me Psalm 16:11. In his presence, in the presence of love, there is fullness of joy. Now for someone who is a justice seeker, the presence of the Lord means being with the people that Jesus was with. Brennan Manning, author of the Ragamuffin Gospel, said, Jesus spent a disproportionate amount of time with what I have come to call the last, the least, the lost, the battered, the scattered, the barred, the scarred, the maimed, the framed, and the shamed. If you want to find Jesus, look for those people. And Jesus is joyful when he's with people that are hurting. He's joyful when he's with people that are angry. He's joyful when he's with people that are abandoned. He's joyful when he's with people that are misunderstood. He's joyful when he's with people that are hungry. And so too will you be. But here's the thing. Joy with Jesus is not a tea party with God. It means that we get out in the world and the world no longer becomes about us. It becomes about all people, and we learn to do what the Bible says, think more of others than we think of ourselves. And believe it or not, when you commit to that kind of life, your joy will be renewed in a way you could not fathom. I want to read just a few words out of this book. Joy is my justice. When you commit to joy as a practice in your life, you embody a way of seeing yourself that then changes how you see everybody else. Let yourself imagine what is possible. Let yourself dream of too much instead of too little. It's time to take up the big space that you were always created for. When I made the commitment in 2024 to really seek the joy of justice, I knew that I would not walk this journey alone. I'm invited to speak all over the United States. But this year, I will not go anywhere to speak unless I take these young people with me. You've heard what I've had to say. God bless you. You've come and you've heard me several times. You know I'm going to talk about justice. You know I'm going to talk about poverty. You know I'm going to talk about racism. You know I'm going to do it. You come anyway. But I ain't going to do that no more. I'm going to let some other folks in on that story that have changed my life. And God gave me this group, and I've called them On Time. It stands for teaching each other, investing in each other, motivating each other, and empowering each other. And I won't travel unless I can take the new voices with me that will always be on time. So I would invite you to think about what it means for you to really walk with those that Jesus spent his time with. And if you ponder that long enough, here's the thing I'll really press you with. What will you do about it? Will you do something, or will you just think about it? We might say, like we do in the South, I pray for you. Yeah. And then you never do. It's the truth. People be honest with me about it, and they say, well, I meant well. Well, it's not enough to mean well. You have to do well. What will you do about what Jesus has done for you? What will you do about a God who gave up everything so you could have life and have it in abundance with joy? Will you do something? Or will you just shake your fist at God and tell him to do something? Please listen. Please watch. Please be blessed. Matthew West, do something.
This morning, saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven.
about you, but I've met people, many of them, who are hungry. Not just hungry for food, but hungry for an emotional boost. Hungry for somebody to care about them. Hungry to know something deeper than themselves. People are hungry. And Jesus gave you the power to feed the world. He gave you power to feed those that are physically hungry. Yes, He did. He gave you power to feed those that are emotionally and mentally starving for somebody to care about them. What will you do about people that are hungry? Will you do something? I don't have to go very far in the places that I walk in life to feel somebody that's abandoned. If you go to your local elementary school, to your local middle school, to your local high school, to your community college, to a state university, you don't have to walk very far before you see this person that's kind of crouched over here by themselves. They're in a crowd of people, but they feel abandoned. They feel lost. You gonna do something about it or just say, well, that's just the way it is in the world? It's only the way it is in the world when we don't change the world. Do you know anybody? Maybe somebody that you see in the mirror that's so angry you don't even know why you're angry anymore. You'll pull out a gun before you'll shake somebody's hand. That is the world we live in. We're just so angry, and we don't really even know what we're so angry about. It's because we've stopped talking to each other. And that's when people are misunderstood. We'll stay on that phone. We'll stay on that computer. We'll watch that TV. We'll do that gaming. But far be it from us that we try to understand somebody that's different from us. What about this broken, busted world that we live in, where Jesus spent all of His time with the last, the least, the lost, the scarred, the barred, the maimed, the framed, the shame, and Jesus just joyful. But Jesus also knew what it was to be abandoned. Jesus knew what it was to be angry. Jesus knew what it was to be misunderstood. Jesus knew what it was to be hungry. And He wanted to know that so He could step into every place with you when you feel angry and you've forgotten about forgiveness. When you feel abandoned or betrayed and you think you have no friends, and God will provide them when you wait on Him. And He always sends the right person at the right time, do I dare say, on time. Do you know what it's like? I've heard so many people, especially my young people, say, I'm just not understood. And that's because we're not listening. We talk a lot, but we listen so little to hear what it is that's important to me. The last time I was at Duck, we had too many people to fit on our van. And so I said, all right, I'll go back and get my truck. So I did, and I thought, oh gosh, when I drive up, Miss Mandy says, some of you got to ride with the preacher. I thought it'll be, oh gosh, this is going to be an unfun day. But I tell you, some of my big boys said, well, we want to ride with Miss Laura. And I said, yes, thank you, Jesus. Nobody's mad because they got to ride with me getting that big old truck. And I take a deep breath, and I said something I never thought I'd say. I said, I'll listen to y'all's music. And I did, for 2 hours. And I met somebody really neat. His name is Rod Wave. Now, some of his stuff is a little tight for me. He got a message. And he sings a song called Abandoned. And it says, the father that left me and the mother that kept me. Yeah. I'm sorry, I won't apologize because I've been traumatized. And if I stay far away from you, it's because I've been abandoned. I listened to those words over and over again, and I said, turn the music off for a minute. I said, is that how y'all feel? Is that how y'all feel? And they said, yes, ma'am. So I listen to a lot of Rod Wave right now. I hadn't been to one of his concerts yet. We have to listen. We have to hear what people are really feeling. What will you do about it? What will you do about it? We have a saying that we like to say as part of On Time. So I want you to listen to what we say because it will bring you joy. And I hope that's what you all leave with today. The ability to be so joyful, you'll do something about what isn't right in your world. I don't know what's wrong in your corner of the world, but I know that everyone within the sound of my voice has a way, has a possibility, has a unique expression to help someone who's angry, to help someone who's abandoned, to help someone who's misunderstood, to help someone who's hungry. Everyone in here, you may not excuse yourself from that kind of joy if you want to follow Jesus. So listen to these words. When you follow Jesus, people will know, they'll know that you have their backs. Show them On Time. You will have their backs. And you will be right on time. You don't have to be afraid to engage with the folks that Jesus engaged with or the ones who cover it up really beautifully, because it's all of us. The world is dealing with abandonment. The world is dealing with anger. The world is dealing with being misunderstood. The world is dealing with hunger. We can shake our fist at God, but we can all decide today to have a renewed sense of joy and step into the places where Jesus lives and moves and has his being. And you know what? When you do that, I promise you, you will be for that person on time. They're waiting for you, church. What will you do about it? In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Behold, you heard this a couple of weeks ago, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be for all in his presence, there's fullness of joy. And he's brought it for you today. It is my heartfelt prayer that before you leave this place today, your joy will be restored. Jesus knew we would get tired. Yeah, he did. Because he got tired. He knew we would get weary. Because he did. But he also knew he could leave us a way to be fully, completely, and wholly restored. He did it on a night where he was about to be betrayed. And he said to the people who surrounded him, as I say to you, as you surround each other, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and receive this at your joy might be restored to his fullness. And on that same night, when he was weary facing betrayal, he took the cup of salvation and he said, this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for all who will come to receive. It's mysterious. It's beautiful. It's real. This is the meal that can restore your joy. But when it is restored, I must ask you to do something about it. Would you pray with me, please? Yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me with my whole heart, I will agree. And my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. Please. My mama taught me how to say please. Silence in me, O God, any voice that is not your own. And please, make us fearlessly faithful as we receive this gift that today is right on time. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, all God's children said together, amen. If my communion stewards would join me. This is the body of Christ. This is the body of Christ. May it restore your joy. This is the body of Christ. May it restore your joy. Amen. Amy, this is the body of Christ. May it restore your joy to its fullness. Be filled with His Spirit. It is His promise. Be filled with His Spirit. It is His promise. Be filled with His Spirit. It is His promise. Be filled with His Spirit. It is His promise. Amen and amen. And now as we go to that place where there is peace and where there is mercy and where there is grace and there is joy, go. Thanks be to God. seen and witnessed some difficult things this year. But what I have not seen is God give up on any of his children. And we must not either. So we will continue to do what we can, when we can, with whoever we can, because God says we can. And I want you today, with joy in your heart, to know how much God is carrying you. These young people do something that I think is quite extraordinary. They work for hours to make prayer crosses, and they're all individual. They're all unique. Every time I see one, I think, ooh, I like that one the best. And then I see the next one, and I like that one the best, too. And on President's Day, they will meet with a lawyer in Apex, North Carolina. They will start their own small business, A Bright Future. Because the way to have our joy restored is when we do something that is going to impact another's life. So if you're interested in looking at their prayer crosses, they're displayed in the fellowship hall. But I hope if you leave with one, you'll handle it with gentleness and tenderness so that as you pray, you can hold others with gentleness and tenderness too. Would you love all my students from on time? One more time.
True definition of a fearless leader. And they have something that they want to say and that they want to do for you.
Hi. We wanted to present to Miss Laura a prayer read that we made for you. Miss Laura is one of the most kind-hearted people that I know, and she does a lot for us, and we want to say thank you. I'm scared of public talking, so I'm going to keep this short. But we love you a lot. We really do. And we appreciate you very much.
I have baptized every one of these young people. It is my heartfelt prayer that today, as mine has, your joy has been restored. Amen.
All right. In just a moment, we're going to receive the offering. And if you would, if you'd take out that connection card that we've got in the bulletin, if there's any next steps that you want to check off there to respond to the message this morning, or even if you want to write something down, just so that you can make a commitment to yourself. There's nothing that we record from these. This is for you and for God, but sometimes it's helpful to do something tangible, to make a commitment when we're in the house of the Lord, to follow through on the way that God has been speaking into our lives. So if you'd like to do that, you can write it down on the card and then place it in the offering. If you're here for the first time today, we're so glad that you've joined us in worship. One of the ways that we love to welcome you is there's a small book at the back of the sanctuary on the table there. There's also a little display about All God's Children, too, if y'all want to see that. But there's a book at the back of the sanctuary called How Good Is Good Enough, and it's a free gift that we would like to give to you. It's just a book that talks about what you have to do to get into heaven, and that's something that we at Duck Church want to make sure that all of you, everyone who comes to visit here, knows. So we would love for you to take one of those books as you leave. And now let's receive God's tithes and offerings. Thank you.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning and some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to. She still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. We are a family whose hearts are blazing, so let's raise our candles and light up the sky, praying to our Father in the name of Jesus, makes us a beacon in darkest times. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, deceived and poor, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world.
Let's stand together and sing with joy. All right?
I was walking the wayside, lost on a lonely road. I was chasing the high life, trying to satisfy my soul. All the lies I believed in left me crying like the rain. I saw lightning from heaven, I'll never be the same. Oh yeah.
I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a world of freedom, I found a friend in Jesus.
Felt the sting of the fire when I saw you in the flames. Just when I thought it was over, you broke me out of the rain. Hallelujah.
I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a world of freedom.
Benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And all God's people said,
Amen.